Hello, welcome everybody to the 39th sessions of Current Affairs 2020 Economy and Banking Concept. So we'll start with the first question. Under which money market instrument in India funds are transacted on an overnight basis? As you remember, in one of our earlier sessions, we have discussed about money market, and money market is a market where financial instruments of tenure less than 1 year are traded. The participants in money markets are banks, NBFCs, primary dealers, and central government, state government. And the main purpose of this money market is to overcome the short-term liquidity shortfalls. Now, among the options, all these are money market instruments. Now the question says, which money market instrument in India funds are transacted on overnight basis? Now if you remember, the answer for this option, this question, is call money. Call money is the money transacted from overnight basis, and the rate of interest involved here is called call rate. Now in call money market, banks as well as NBFCs can participate, where with collateral and without collateral both are possible. When it comes to without collateral security, only banks are there to borrow money without collateral from another bank. Whereas a collateral, which is known as CBLO, there NBFCs can also lend as well as borrow money in the call money market, where it is overnight lending. Whereas notice money is from 2 days to 14 days. Notice money is again a borrowing concept. A bank can borrow from another bank, but that is for 2 days to 14 days. And there is one more thing called term money, which is from 14 days, 15 days to 1 year. That is for term money. So call money, notice money, term money, out of that call money is overnight. Certificates of deposits and commercial papers, these are also money market instruments, and in next few slides we'll again discuss about commercial papers and certificate of deposits. Remember, call rate is not regulated by anybody. That means neither the bank nor the RBI regulate call money or call rate. Rather, it depends on the demand and supply of the liquidity available with the banks in the call money market. So call money and the call rate are not regulated by RBI or the banks. The call rate keeps on changing on time to time basis. On everyday basis, the call rate is listed in the website of RBI. Okay, let us move to the next question. Banks in India normally give additional interest on term deposits. Now, as you recall, there are two types of deposits: demand deposit and term deposit. Demand deposits are deposit like savings account deposit and current account deposits, where the customer can withdraw the money whenever they are going to demand it. On the other side, a term deposit is a deposit where the depositor withdraws or gets the money after a pre-decided time period, maybe 6 months, 1 year or 2 years. Under term deposit, we have fixed deposit and recurring deposit. A fixed deposit is one where you pay the amount only once and you get the principal amount plus interest at the end of the maturity period. And sometime it also gets auto renewal. This is the term you may come across in any of the exams, auto renewal. Auto renewal means, suppose I made a fixed deposit for 6 months of 10,000 rupees. Now after 6 months, I'll get something around, say, 600 rupees as an interest. Now, after 6 months, if I withdraw, I should get 10,600 rupees. But suppose I have not withdrawn it, and while making the fixed deposit, I have opted for an option called auto renewal. In that case, the bank will automatically make that 10,600 rupees as a new fixed deposit in my name. So in that case, the principal amount will become 10,600 rupees. I hope it is clear. In the first fixed deposit, 10,000 was my principal amount. At the end of the tenure, my interest was 600 rupees. Now, if it gets auto renewal, when it gets new fixed deposit, the principal amount will become 10,600 and the compound interest will be calculated on 10,600. Okay. Now the question here is, banks in India normally give additional interest on term deposits for government employees, below poverty line people, rural women, senior citizens and business people. I'm sure by now many of you could guess the answer is senior citizens. The rate of interest are generally some 0.5 percentage point higher than the other cases. So I have given you an example of this. So if you see non-senior citizens for NRO deposit, this is like 4.5%, but for senior citizen it is from 5%. Then for 6 to 12 months it is 5.80%, and senior citizens it is 6.30%. So if you see, generally it is 0.5 percentage point more than the normal accounts or account or normal fixed deposits to the senior citizen deposits. Okay. On the contrary, if you look at in case of borrowing also, lending also, there are cases where the rate of interest are less in certain cases. For example, bank employees. When a bank employee borrows from the same bank, the rate of interest are less. The rule of base rate is not applicable in that case. If you remember, what is base rate? Base rate is the minimum rate of interest below which a bank does not lend. Now, that rule is almost applicable for, you know, most of the loans, but there are some special cases like a loan to a bank employee, then agricultural loans where the rate of interest could be lesser than the base rate, or some subsidized loan or rate of interest, their rate of interest could be even zero also, where the interest is paid by the government. So this type of scheme is known as interest subvention scheme. It happened earlier, like in case of fertilizer companies, when the economic slowdown takes place, or suppose fertilizer companies are yet to get a lot of payment from the central government, and now they are in short of funds so that they cannot move towards the further production of fertilizers. In those situations, Government of India brought a scheme called interest subvention scheme. So what is that scheme? In that scheme, those fertilizer companies were allowed to take a loan from the banks, but without any interest. That interest will be paid by the government. So this type of schemes are called interest subvention scheme. Okay. Recently, a special scheme has been launched for the women SHG self-help groups, where they can get a loan up to 5 lakh rupees without any interest. It's not that the banks will not get interest. The banks will get the interest, but the interest will be paid by the central government through SIDBI or NABARD as a some subvention scheme. Okay. So coming back to the question, the answer for this question is senior citizens. Let us move to the next question. Which is an investment advisory service that combines other financial services to address the needs of an affluent client? If you look at this word affluent client, who is an affluent client? An affluent client is somebody who has a surplus amount of cash available with that person. They are also known as HNI, high net worth individual, HNI customers. high net worth individuals. Now they generally have a huge amount lying in their savings account or maybe current account. Now, which is an investment advisory service that combines other financial services to address the needs of affluent clients? The answer is wealth management. Wealth management. That means in that case, the bank is also providing consultations that how the funds available with that person should be utilized, whether he should invest in gold or he should invest in share market or systematic investment plan, SIP. SIP, this question also appears in bank exams number of times. What does SIP stands for? SIP stands for systematic investment plan. This is related with mutual fund. So here, whether the person should invest in share market or land or maybe other call money instruments, the bank helps that person to invest, and that is what is called wealth management. When it comes to onshore and offshore banking, offshore banking is like a Indian bank. For example, suppose a branch or a bank is performing banking practices outside that country for the Indian customers. So for example, say let's say some XYZ Bank of India, and it goes to Mauritius or maybe Dubai or maybe Singapore, which is generally that, or maybe some other tax havens where the tax rates are less, goes there and facilitates the Indian businessman or the businessman of that country to keep a deposit in that country or to perform business in that country. Now please understand, it has got a contradiction also, issue is there. Now why there is a offshore banking? What is the benefit? Now for example, let's say Mr. X, who is a very affluent and he has got a lot of money and he pays a huge income tax. Now suppose he makes a fixed deposit of 50 lakh rupees. Now if he makes a fixed deposit of 50 lakh rupees, the interest earned by on that fixed deposit rupees is also taxable. Remember, the interest earned on that 50 lakh rupees is also taxable. But then if that person deposits that 50 lakh rupees in some offshore banking branch in any of the tax haven, so he need not pay the interest on the fixed deposits. This is one advantage. On the same line, if he is having a business in that country, so he needs cash in that country and that too in that currency, which will be easier for him. So what he do, he will deposit the money in that branch from India in Indian rupees, and in that country he will withdraw the money in that local currency. So as a result, what happens, he need not actually pay the commission to convert his currency to dollar and then again dollar to that currency that currency of that country. So this time he has to pay two times, he has to pay this commission to exchange his forex. But if he has any of this offshore banking facility, so what he does, he deposits the money in India and then withdraws the money in that local currency from that offshore branch. So these two are two primary advantages of offshore banking. However, also remember that it is argued that offshore banking in some way boosts money laundering and illegal transactions, so, or hidden transactions. So that argument is also there. So in that way, offshore banking need to be well managed and well regulated. Okay, so coming back, onshore banking is actually these two words are opposite. Onshore banking is you are doing the business in your own country, that is onshore banking. Offshore banking, you move out of your geographical territory and do it in some other country, that is offshore banking. Trade finance, you can easily guess, you are financing a body which is financing trade. So for example, if I look at Exim Bank, Export Import Bank, so what does they do? They are into financing of export and import, that is their financing trade. So Exim Bank is specializing its operation into trade financing. If you look at, there is another name called ECGC, Export Credit Guarantee Corporation. ECGC stands for Export Credit Guarantee Corporation. When you write IBPS exam, IBPS PO exam, and if you look at the list of the banks where this you can actually get recruited, in previous year the name of ECGC was also there. That means the recruitment of ECGC was also through IBPS PO exam. So ECGC, look at the name, Export Credit Guarantee Corporation. So what does they do? They actually provide guarantee. They are the guarantors. Guarantors to whom? Guarantors for the exporters. Now, please understand. Suppose I would like to export something to Sri Lanka, and to do that, I need some fund from the bank. Now also understand, when I'm exporting, it is a time-taking process. That means I'll export, the money can reach there and the money will come, and there are some complications are there. Now to do that, I need to borrow some money from the bank. Now by nature, banks will always look for some security against it. But then I may not have that sufficient amount of assets to give it as a security. There ECGC comes and tells the bank, don't worry, you keep borrowing to that person and I am the guarantor. So if anything goes wrong or he or she becomes defaulter, I am going to give you the money. So that is a guarantee. Now the question comes, why ECGC is going to do it? And is the guarantees available in all the cases? So if you think, it's quite easy to understand. For an economy to improve, export is very important. You know, export is always given your trade deficit, it will reduce your trade deficit, and if we have a more export and less import, we'll be moving towards trade surplus. For a country like India, our one of the biggest economic challenges, we are always in trade deficit. Now government wants the export to increase. Now to boost export, they want some organization to play the role of a guarantor, so that a person like me, if I want to export, I don't need to, you know, don't face the shortage of fund, and if I approach a bank, the ECGC will help me to get that fund. Similar other guarantee options are there under CGT also. It's called CGT SME, where entrepreneur, if he or she wants to start a factory or some manufacturing unit, and when he or she approaches SIDBI or a bank, banks looks for a security. Now that may not be available, that huge amount of security or asset may not be available to cover the entire loan. So there SIDBI comes and works as a guarantor. So this type of schemes are there for various economic sectors. Coming to industrial finance, by now I am sure you would have understood that what is industrial finance. So if trade finance is done by Exim Bank, industrial finance are done by banks like SIDBI and banks like even IDBI, Industrial Development Bank, BI, Bank of India. Industrial Development Bank of India, when it was started, it was into industrial financing exclusively. Later it became a commercial bank. So if you look at ICICI Bank, if you look at the full form of ICICI Bank, Industrial Credit and ICICI, Industrial Credit and Investment Corporation of India, Industrial Credit and Investment Corporation of India. Remember, it was only in 1994-95 ICICI became a bank. It is not that it started in 1994-95, it was there in India well before 1994-95 as an industrial finance institute. Then in 1994, that after government of India thought of giving license to private parties, ICICI become a bank, and it has become a general bank or a commercial bank named as ICICI Bank. One of the very early organization after independence, you can say the first financial institution formed by Government of India is Industrial Finance Corporation of India, IFCI, Industrial Finance Corporation of India, Industrial Finance Corporation of India. Then we also have IIFCL, Indian Infrastructure Finance Corporation Limited. Indian Infrastructure Finance Corporation Limited, Indian Infrastructure Finance Corporation Limited, IIFCL. So based on that, we can have industrial finance or trade finance. Okay, so coming back to the question, the answer for this question is wealth management. And also remember, affluent clients are also known as HNI, high net worth individual. Let's move to the next question. Dash is a short term unsecured promissory notes issued by companies. Remember, Dash is a short term unsecured promissory note issued by companies. Now let me take these words one by one. Promissory note. So what is a promissory note? A promissory note is a written promise. Our currency notes are also a promissory note. If you look at a currency note, you will find that it is written that I promise to pay the bearer rupees 50. This is a promissory note. But the difference with the simple promise made by me on a white paper and the promise made in a currency note is different. In a currency note, the promise is backed up by the governor of RBI. The governor of RBI endorses our promise by signing it. So in every currency note, we have the signature of the governor of India, RBI. A promissory note could be any other documents through which we make a promise of repayment or a delivery of something. Now a short term. Generally, when it comes to money market, more than 1 year tenure is considered as a long term and less than 1 year tenures are considered as short term. And secured and unsecured, in terms of promissory notes or secured monetary notes, are those notes which are promises made by the banks or promises made by RBI. Like for example, currency notes, they are the promises made by RBI or backed up by RBI, so it's a secured promissory note. If you look at a demand draft and a check, demand draft is also a financial instrument, check is also a financial instrument. In both the cases, I am actually making an order or a promise that I am going to make some payment. But when it comes to demand draft, it's a secured note. When it comes to a check, it is an unsecured instrument. A demand draft where the promise is made by the bank. The bank is making the promise. The name of the bank is written and my money, if I am making the demand draft, my money from my account gets transferred to the bank's account and it remains with the bank. So whenever the person who is bearing the demand draft is going to demand it on the bank, bank is definitely going to pay that person. So here the promise is made by the bank. So it's a secured promissory note. When it comes to a check, bank facilitates that, you know, check leaf, but the signing and endorsement is everything by the drawer of the check, the customer who writes the check, the drawer of the check. Here he signs it. So it is kind of an unsecured instrument. So check is an unsecured instrument, demand draft is a secured instrument. So let me come to this point once again. Short term, less than 1 year. Unsecured in the sense, who is making the promise? Is it bank making the promise or somebody else is making the promise? And since this is promises made by companies, these are unsecured and promissory notes. Treasury bills is not the correct answer because treasury bill are issued by the central government of India and they are highly secured. Certificates of deposits are issued by the banks. This is again a money market instrument. This is also a secured instrument and money market instrument. Equity share is not a promissory note. Equity share is also not a short term because it is a capital market instrument. Equity share is a capital market instrument, and capital market instruments are generally considered as a long term, where you would like to get the profit share or maybe the business share of something. So it is not a promissory note. You are getting a share of the business. Dividend is nothing but the share of profit you earn when you own a equity in a company. For example, you have shares of TCS, and in a certain quarter TCS made X crores of profit. Now TCS thinks that of that X crore, some percentage I am going to distribute among my shareholders. So you being one of the shareholder, you will get proportionate amount of share of that profit, which is known as dividend. In simple language, dividend is nothing but share of profit. Equity share and dividend are not promissory note. Commercial paper, treasury bills and certificates of deposits are promissory notes. Commercial paper is the answer because commercial papers are issued by companies. But take a note, I've also discussed this in earlier classes. Not every company can issue commercial papers. So who can issue a commercial paper? Companies only with very good credit rating. As per the RBI norms, companies with very good credit rating can issue commercial papers. Now, coming back to the question, the answer for this question is option number one, commercial papers. Let us move to the next question. Which of the following is are true about bank rate? Which of the following is are true about bank rate? Bank rate is charged against loans offered by central bank to commercial banks. Bank rate is charged against loans offered by central bank to commercial banks. Yes, if you remember, under policy rates, we had four rates. One is a repo rate, policy repo rate, reverse repo rate, marginal standing facility and bank rate. These four were the parts of policy rates, which in turn is a part of monetary policy. No collateral is involved while charging the bank rate. Bank rate is always higher than repo rate. Bank rate caters to long-term financial requirements of commercial banks. Answer is all of the above. Absolutely correct. Please understand, repo rate is for short term, and to get some money from RBI in terms of repo facility, the name itself is repurchase agreement, where actually a bank gives some security, government securities, to RBI and tells them I'm going to repurchase this after some time. So this government securities are given as collateral. So when a bank borrows from RBI under repo facility, there is a collateral involved and it is a short term, and also the amount of money is also relatively smaller. Reverse repo rate is entirely opposite, where RBI borrows money from banks. MSF is slightly different. A bank is out of its resources, it is exhausted with all its government securities to get a repo loan. So what it does, it can use some government securities which are kept as SLR to adjust its liquidity shortfall. I'm repeating it. For MSF, the bank has no longer a scope to borrow money from RBI because it is exhausted. It does not have any more government securities extra. Now what it does, it still has some government securities as a statutory liquidity ratio reserve, and from that part it can go down by 2% or 3% and exchange that government security in terms of liquidity. But in bank rate, there is no collateral involved, and also remember, this is for long term and relatively higher amount of borrowing from RBI. So answer is all of this. Okay, very important question. Please make sure you keep this in mind. What is the minimum bid size for liquidity adjustment facility? The minimum bid size for liquidity adjustment facility is 5 crore. Now, what is this liquidity adjustment facility, or it is also known as liquidity corridor? This is nothing but the gap between the repo rate and reverse repo rate. The gap between repo rate and reverse repo rate is known as corridor. On 22nd May 2020, RBI has again revised its repo rate. Earlier it was 4.40% and it has been reduced by 40 basis points to 4%, whereas reverse repo rate has been reduced to 3.35%, and that gap of 0.65% is the corridor. Now in that corridor, all the money market instrument has to play its role. Now when anybody participates in that repo market, when it goes to repo market, the commercial banks, the minimum bid size is 5 crores. The answer is option number 3. So it comes with a multiple of 5 crores, 5 crores, 10 crores, like that. The minimum bid size is 5 crores. Remember, repo rate is recently getting reduced, and the present repo rate is the lowest ever repo rate in the RBI history. The present repo rate is 4%, and it has further reduced from 4.40%. Stirling Moss, who passed away recently, was associated with. Stirling Moss is a very renowned Formula One racing veteran, passed away, was associated with Formula One racing. National Panchayati Raj Day is celebrated on dash of every year. National Panchayati Raj Day is celebrated on dash every year. The answer is 24th April. 24th April. National Civil Service Day is 21st April. National Civil Service Day. 22nd April, World Art Day. And 23rd April is English Language Day. That's a UN Observance Day, English Language Day. On 20th April, there is no as such important observance. So the answer for this question is option number 3, 24th April. Let's move to the next question. The parliamentary panel on labor submitted its report on the Industrial Relations Code 2019 to Lok Sabha Speaker. The panel is headed by. If you look at this particular report, why this is important in today's perspective? What is the significance of this particular report? Now, if you remember, when this COVID-19 pandemic started, actually, we heard that central government said, and in fact requested, that the companies and the organizations should pay salaries to their employees even if the business is stuck up, business is stopped, and they should pay the salary on regular basis. And whether this is a mandate, whether this is a, they are bound to pay the salary or not, that was a big question. So this particular committee, which was headed by Bhartruhari Mahatab, that committee actually said that no, you cannot impose a mandate on the companies and the industry to pay salary to the employees. The report has been submitted recently. The logic they used is the ban or the inability of the production is not because of the owner of the factories or owner of the companies. Rather, the ban is imposed on it. So it is not their fault, and since it was imposed and it is for a long duration, This cannot be made mandatory to the industrialist or maybe the owner of the organizations. If you look at the rest of the names, they are mostly present MP or ex-MP. Kirit Somya is an ex-MP of Maharashtra. Bhupendra Yadav is an MP of Rajya Sabha from BJP. And Mr. Mehtab is also an MP from BJP. Sudeep Bandyopadhyay is an MP of Trinamool Congress. So answer for this question is Bhartuhari Mehtab, option number 3, who was the head of the committee. Let's move to the next question. Which is the first state in India to initiate the protocol of plasma treatment therapy to treat COVID-19 patients? Initiate the protocol for plasma therapy. In fact, what is this plasma therapy? Plasma therapy is a treatment in which the blood plasma of a blood of a person who has recovered from that disease is taken and infused in the body of an infected patient. Let me repeat it. Suppose there is Mr. X who was COVID-19 infected, but he has recovered. That means his body has generated that antigen to fight COVID. Now that blood sample is taken and from that the plasma is taken and that is infused to Mr. Y, who is infected with COVID-19. So what happened? That antibody actually fights with the virus and makes sure that the person is recovered. Now, US has tried to implement it. Among the Indian state, the answer is Kerala, which has initiated the protocol and in fact successfully treated patient. Now, is it a cure? Is it a well-established cure? No, there are a lot of work to be done. It won't stop spread of COVID. It won't stop getting infected. But it can cure a patient who is infected by the COVID. Now, and is it for everybody? As per the recent report, it says this particular way of treating COVID-19 plasma should be implemented to the semi-severe to severe patients. In those cases where the medicines are not responding properly, their plasma therapy may be implemented. So it is not fully established, but yes, there are success stories, and this has been initiated by Kerala in India. So answer is option number 2. We discussed this term earlier. Indian Council for Medical Research has approved it. ICMR has approved it. Professor Balram Bhargava is the secretary, director of health research and director general of ICMR, Indian Council for Medical Research. Repeatedly we are coming across this particular term in newspapers, so it is important. And at present, Professor Balram Bhargava is the secretary of director of health research and director general of ICMR. Which among the following became the first Indian to win Fed Cup Heard Award for Asia Oceanic Zone? Now, if you know this particular thing about Fed Cup, actually it's quite easy to answer. Fed Cup is actually for women. It is the, you can say, it's a World Cup of tennis for women, where the players represent their country, like Davis Cup we have. Davis Cup, it's a World Cup for tennis where the male players participate, and Fed Cup is for women player for tennis where they represent their country. So Leander Page, Mohesh Bhupathi, Rohan Bopanna, all are eliminated. The answer is Sania Mirza. The Fed Cup Heard Award of Asia and Oceanic Zone is based on the votes cast by the people, and Sania Mirza, after giving birth to a baby, she has returned to the court and recently won this doubles title in Howard International Now, and also made sure that India can move to the next round in Fed Cup after beating Indonesia. So she has been awarded with this award, Fed Cup Hard Award for Asia and Oceanic Zone. Remember, in Fed Cup, the Indian team beat Indonesia to move to the next level, next round. The United States has placed India on its priority watch list. The list is related to intellectual property rights. If you look at intellectual property rights in India, it's like we know that in intellectual property rights in India are not so stringent. So the priority watch list of United States Trade Representatives, USTR, United States Trade Representatives, for lack of intellectual property rights, protections and enforcements. So there are some rules and regulations, but they are not implemented properly, as they are saying. And this is mostly into the pharmaceutical sector. So the drugs which are developed by USA-based pharmaceutical companies, when they are launched in India, some copying or the piracy type of things are taking place. And that's not only in India, it's happening in other countries also, maybe China or maybe Argentina or Russia. So for that, this USTR has put these countries in priority watch list. So answer is intellectual property watch list. The Regional Specialized Meteorological Center, RSMC, which is mandated to name the tropical cyclones developing over the North Indian Ocean, including Bay of Bengal and Arabian Sea, is located. The question is very simple. They are asking, where is the head office of RSMC located? Now, and what is the main responsibility of RSMC? They are there to predict and name the tropical cyclones which are developing over Bay of Bengal or Arabian Sea. This is quite significant in recent, but if you look at in last 5-6 years, whatever cyclones are hitting India, like we actually got our information well in advance and we could have time to prepare. Our disaster management team could get time to prepare and evacuate people from those affected areas. Recently, we know that cyclone Amphan, which hit West Bengal and parts of Orissa, is also a matter of concern. It seems one of the super cyclones in the last so many years which has hit India, Amphan, the super cyclone. So Regional Specialized Meteorological Center for Tropical Cyclones over North India, under Indian Meteorological Department, Ministry of Earth Science, Government of India. Okay, the head office is in New Delhi. The answer for this question, the head office is in New Delhi. Which type of mode? Next question, which type of mode is not allowed for withdrawing cash at point of sale, POS terminals? So the question says, among these options, using which type you cannot withdraw a cash from a POS terminal? Using debit card, you can draw it. Open system prepaid account, credit card, electronic cards provided under PMJDY, Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana account, none of the above. The answer is credit card. Using credit card, cash withdrawn can be done only from selected ATMs. From no other point, the cash withdrawal can be performed. Debit card, cash withdrawal can be performed. Now, if you look at prepaid accounts, it's like prepaid instruments, prepaid payment instruments. There are three types: closed, semi-closed, and open system. Closed cannot be used for cash withdrawal. Closed prepaid payment instruments like MetroPass, or maybe you use a make a card when you walk into some food court, they cannot be used for withdrawing cash, neither you can use it outside. There are semi-closed prepaid accounts or cards which can be used for payment purpose, for buying something, for transferring amount, but they cannot use for cash withdrawal. Open system prepaid accounts can be used for cash withdrawal, like travel cards. For example, this company called TransCrop International, this is the first non-banking company in India to get a license to issue a prepaid payment account instrument like this. They are payment cards. You can make payments as well as you can withdraw cash using this type of cards. Remember, TransCrop International is the first non-banking company in India to issue a open system prepaid payment account and prepaid instrument. Electronic cards provided under Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana account. These cards look like this. They are rupee card. You can see Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana is written over here. There is no name of a bank is given. So they are like same for wherever you are issuing a or opening a Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana account in rural areas. May it be some cooperative bank or maybe some regional rural bank. You go and open a Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana. This type of electronic cards are given and they can use it to withdraw cash or make payments. So these are debit cards, kind of a debit card only. So out of this, the answer is credit card. Cash withdrawal cannot be done using a credit card at POS, point of sale. This term is also sometimes important. They ask you, what does POS, POS stands for? Who has appointed Managing Director and Chief Executive Officer of Paytm General Insurance Limited? Paytm, we know the payment bank. They have also ventured into general insurance. There are two types of insurance, life insurance and general insurance. As we know, life insurance is like the insurance which is provided by LIC or Tata Life or HDFC Life. Whereas general insurance are like health insurance, car insurance, then travel insurance, companies like NICL, National Insurance Company Limited, then General Insurance Company Limited. So they are all general insurance company. Now Paytm General Insurance Limited is a new company which has been started by Paytm. The answer for this question is Vinit Arora. Vinit Arora, option number 4. Vinit Arora. For rest of the names are not so important, so I am not touching upon that. They are mostly, they are some assistant professors or professors in different colleges. They are good authors and they are good scholars. They are good publications. The answer for this one is Vinit Arora, option number 4. Which of the following members of parliament has been reappointed chairperson of Parliament Public Accounts Committee, PAC? This member has been reappointed as the chairperson of Parliament's Public Accounts Committee, PAC. Okay, so among the options, the answer is Adhir Ranjan Chaudhary. Now this can be also guessed if you know some details about PAC. Now, what is a PAC? PAC is a parliamentary committee that examines the report of CAG, Comptroller and Auditor General. CAG is a constitutional body appointed by the President of India. And their responsibility is to do the audit of the expenses made by the government. And these reports are further checked by Public Accounts Committee, that is PAC. Now the purpose of checking is not sheer only checking and just to check whether all the expenses are okay or not. The purpose is also to check whether there is any waste, loss, corruption, extravagant or inefficient expenses. Now, there are total 22 members in the committee, 15 from Lok Sabha and 7 from Rajya Sabha. And the Speaker of the Parliament decides who should be the chairman among the members, and generally it is from the opposition parties. So let me repeat once again. PAC is very important in terms of IAS exams. However, in bank exams also sometimes we see a few questions coming from constitution or polity related. Now this is one such question. PAC is a parliamentary accounts committee. There are total 22 members, 15 from Lok Sabha and 7 from Rajya Sabha. The chairman is appointed by the speaker, and generally the chairman is from opposition party. So the answer is Adhir Ranjan Chaudhary, who is a Congress MP, National Congress MP from Behrampur, West Bengal. Adhir Ranjan Chaudhary, National Congress MP from Behrampur. So the answer for this is option number 3. The present CAG of India is Rajiv Maharshi. This could be a direct question in bank exam. Present Comptroller and Auditor General. Present Comptroller and Auditor General of India is Rajiv Maharshi. This could be a direct question. Please remember that. Let's move to the next question. With which institution has the Coir Board signed a Memorandum of Understanding to establish a Center of Excellence for the application of coir exclusively or in combination with other natural fibers? Coir, as you know, the fibers we obtain from a coconut shell. Now, the National Coir Board signed an agreement with IIT Madras, IIT Madras, for further technological development and application of coir with combination of other natural fibers. The answer is IIT Madras. The Government of India has revised the minimum support price, MSP, important question in bank's perspective, for minor forest produce. Which of the following is the monitoring agency for the implementation of MSP in states? Okay, now what is this MSP? The minimum support price is the price at which government procure a certain commodity, certain produce of the farmers, certain produce from the farmers. Now, as long as this is concerned, this minimum support price is decided by Cabinet Committee on Economic Affairs, CCEA, Cabinet Committee on Economic Affairs, based on the recommendation of Commission for Agricultural Cost and Prices. So they recommend, Commission for Agricultural Cost and Prices, CACP, they recommend to CCEA, Cabinet Committee on Economic Affairs, and they take the final decision. Once the decision is taken, then the responsibility of procurement of the produce from the farmers is with FCI, Food Corporation of India, and then they store it in FCI godowns. We have seen in and around us, we see FCI godowns are there. So their responsibility is to buy and to store. But when it comes to minor forest produce, these are mostly for tribal groups. The produce we are talking about, the tribal people who collect it from forest. The produce is collected from forest and sold in the market. So for that also there are MSPs. So in the new scheme, recently they have increased this particular price, revised it for minor forest produce, and also included some 20 new items like cardamom, then bamboo shoots, similar thing, ginger, ban tulsi, this type of produces which the tribals go to the forest and collect it, and then they can sell it to the market or to the government. Those prices has been revised, and in states the responsibility is of or with TriFed, tribal, TriFed stands for Tribal Cooperative Marketing Development Federation of India, Tribal Cooperative Development Marketing Development Federation of India. So answer is TriFed. Among the options, if you look at EPIDA, EPIDA stands for Agricultural and EPIDA stands for EPIDA stands for Agricultural and Processed Food Products Export Development Authority. EPIDA stands for Agricultural and Processed Food Products Export Development Authority under Ministry of Commerce. Head office is in New Delhi. Head office is in New Delhi. Then MPDA stands for Marine Product Export and Development Authority. So EPIDA A stands for Agriculture Product, MP stands for Marine Product, EDA Export Development Authority. NAFED, N-A-F-E-D, NAFED, National Agriculture Cooperative Marketing Federation of India. National Agricultural Cooperative Marketing Federation of India Limited. NAFED is responsible for marketing agricultural produce within the country. EPIDA is responsible for outside the country. NAFED is under Ministry of Agriculture. EPIDA is under Ministry of Commerce. TriFed is Tribal Cooperative Marketing Development Federation of India. Tribal Cooperative Marketing Development Federation of India. The answer for this question, as you have seen, this is MSP is actually related to the tribals. The answer is TriFed, option number 4. Okay, let us move to the next question. A commemorative stamp to make the 40th commemorative stamp to make the 40th anniversary of the eradication of dash has been released by the World Health Organization. Of which of the following disease has been eradicated, and it is the 40th anniversary of this, and to commemorate that a stamp has been released by World Health Organization, WHO. Now, if you look at the answer from these options, is answer is smallpox. Actually, rest of the diseases are still, found in small in numbers, but then smallpox is almost eradicated, and the answer is smallpox. As long as polio is concerned, India is now considered as a polio-free nation. However, the vaccines of polio are still continuing, and the vaccines usually given in India, the National Immunization Mission, under National Immunization Mission, the vaccines are given, whatever vaccines are given, are called BCG. BCG, this is Bacillus Calmette-Guerin vaccine, BCG. It is given after birth. OPV stands for oral polio vaccine. Hepatitis B vaccine, HBV. BCG vaccine is for tuberculosis. HBV for hepatitis B vaccine. OPV, oral polio vaccine. Then at 6 months time, these vaccines are given. DTP vaccine, DTP, diphtheria, tetanus and pertussis, DTP vaccine. Then it's called HIV vaccine, in short it is called HIV, H-I-V, HIV vaccine, hemophilus influenza type B vaccine and measles. Now in today's context, I would like to put some point on measles. If you look at measles, is also a very highly contagious illness caused by a virus that reciprocates in a, reproduce in nose and throat and spreads through air by the respiratory droplets. Please understand, this is also spreads in nose and reproduces in nose and throat, highly contagious and spreads when we talk or when we sneeze or coughing, and with those droplets it spreads. So very similar to COVID. However, the vaccine for measles is available, so that's why we are not so aware about measles as a disease. So these are some of the vaccines are used in India as a part of national immunization program: BCG, HBV, OPV at the birth at 6 months, DTP and HIV vaccine and measles. So these are the vaccines applicable as per national immunization program. The answer for this question is smallpox. Next question: who among the following is the author of the book Politics of Opportunism? Who among the following is the author of the book Politics of Opportunism? The answer is R.N.P. Singh. R.N.P. Singh is a former officer of Intelligence Bureau. His book is this, R.N.P. Singh. Manmohan Singh, as such, there is no recent book, but yes, there's a book called To the Nation, For the Nation. It is based on To the Nation, comma, For the Nation. It is a book based on the speeches made by Manmohan Singh at different instances. To the Nation and For the Nation. Balachandra Murugesh is as such an economist. His book is like Meri Hakikat, is quite famous, and is also considered as an expert on B.R. Ambedkar. He did a lot of studies on B.R. Ambedkar. C. Rangarajan is a famous economist, ex-RBI governor, and U.K. Sinha, former SEBI chairperson. U.K. Sinha is former SEBI, S-E-B-I, Securities Exchange Board of India, SEBI chairperson, and his book is Going Public, My Time at SEBI. Going Public, My Time at SEBI. Okay, so answer for this question is option number 3, R.N.P. Singh. Which has developed India's first antibody testing kit, ELISA? Very important, please remember. First antibody testing kit, ELISA. Now, what is this ELISA actually? ELISA is a methodology of testing. The full form is enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay. Now, I'm sure you have seen this type of kits are used for testing of disease like typhoid or maybe malaria. This type of kit testings are available. This process of kit testing is nothing but ELISA, enzyme-linked immunoassay. So it's already there in the system. But what is so special about this? This ELISA is actually for testing COVID cases. Now, prior to that, we had this rapid testing kit which were imported from China. Rapid testing kits which were imported from China, and as we have heard, that those kits were faulty, that they were not producing very sensitive and authentic results. Then India decided to invest and develop the kit indigenously, and which has been done successfully. The answer for this question is National Institute of Virology, Pune, who has successfully developed it and has also gone for mass production. Gujarat-based company Zydus Cadila, who has been given the responsibility for the production of the first lot of this kit, ELISA kit for COVID-19, which is claimed to be very sensitive and accurate and also fast compared to the earlier kit, rapid testing kit, which was imported from China. So answer for this question is option number 4, ELISA kit for COVID-19, indigenous kit developed by National Institute of Virology, Pune. Which country has topped in 2020 World Economic Forum's Global Energy Transition. Now, this Global Energy Transition is an index based on economic development, environmental sustainability, energy security, and similar parameters. In this particular ranking, the first place is taken by Sweden, followed by Switzerland and Finland. Sweden is top spot, followed by Switzerland and Finland. Remember, India's position in this index is 74th. Slight improvement from the last rating. India's position in this rating 2020 is 74. Let us move to the next question. Answer for this question is option number 2, Sweden. Who produced the report? World Economic Forum. The head office of World Economic Forum is Geneva, Switzerland. World Economic Forum's head office is Geneva, Switzerland. Which bank has tied up with MoneyGram, a payment system, to offer a cost-effective direct to bank account credit option for customers in India? Now, what is this? When we have to transfer some money abroad, so then what we have to do? We have to go out from our house and we have to look for some MoneyGram counter or maybe some other vendors, Western Union, to send money to abroad. And the same thing, when somebody or some NRI who is residing outside India wants to transfer money to his family members, these are the way he has to go, move out and then transfer to Western Union branch, and the person need to go to that branch to collect the money. Whereas if you look at MoneyGram, is a US based company, is a global leader in cross-border peer-to-peer payment system. MoneyGram is a US-based company, is a global leader in cross-border peer-to-peer payment system. That means peer-to-peer means I'm paying to my relative or somebody else, peer-to-peer payment system. Now, among the options, the answer is Federal Bank. Federal Bank, based out of Kerala, was tied up with MoneyGram. In that way, NRI can transfer the money, which will be credited directly to the bank account of the customer. So answer is Federal Bank. The CEO of Federal Bank is Shyam Srinivasan. The CEO of Federal Bank is Shyam Srinivasan. It's there on the left of your screen, Shyam Srinivasan. The Sorai Kober painting of Dash has received the GI tag, Geographical Indication tag. The answer is Jharkhand. It's the Hazaribagh district of Jharkhand where the locals make this type of printing using the naturally available soils of different color. And that is so unique that you cannot produce this by some artificial system, and that's why it has got a special GI tagging with it. Sorai Kober painting of Jharkhand, Hazaribagh district. Along with that, another product got GI tagging, which is called Telia Rumal of Telangana. Telia Rumal of Telangana, which has also got GI tag, source at Telangana. Telia Rumal print of Telangana. Chief Minister of Jharkhand is Hemant Soren and Chief Minister of Telangana is K. Chandrasekhar Rao. CM of Jharkhand, Hemant Soren, and Chief Minister of Telangana, K. Chandrasekhar Rao. Which car manufacturing corporation has rolled out an end-to-end online vehicle ownership titled Own Online? So you can understand what is this. It's not very complicated. Own to own, end-to-end means starting from selection, payment, delivery and orientation. Entire process is done online without any physical contact. So this has been launched by Mahindra and Mahindra. Mahindra and Mahindra has launched this solution for the customers recently. The chairman of Mahindra and Mahindra Group is Mr. Anand Mahindra. Chairman is Mr. Anand Mahindra. Thank you.